This talk is mainly about OpenMP for accelerators. And I lost my name badge, sorry. I'm still Christian Terboven, still deputy head of the HPC group here at the IT Center. I'm still wanting to say Center for Computing and Communication, but we changed our name. And in the previous talk, Tim talked about several options to program for these accelerators. And especially if you're new to working with these kinds of devices, you might be overwhelmed in what to start with. And my recommendation is really, if you just want to explore this brave new world of accelerators, then you might want to start with this OpenMP 4.0 extension to carry on your the OpenMP constructs or your OpenMP knowledge to these accelerators. And I will briefly talk about what's an accelerator in the terms of OpenMP. And my intent with that is to make clear that there's a path towards the future. So I said that this accelerator model will go away, that this offload model will go away, but the basic accelerator features will kind of find their way into the system. For example, it might be part of future CPUs. So on Monday I talked about Moore's Law, so there's plenty of room to integrate more transistors in the processors already. So things might converge as they did in the past. But that's just my personal opinion and projection. Okay, so what we learn here today is not what we will throw away. What we will throw away in the future, I think, are the cards that we are working with today. Then I will talk briefly about the execution and data model, and then illustrate the use of the target construct. And that's the main extension of OpenMP, and as I mentioned, I think, yesterday, the goal was really to take all what we have already to express parallelism and carry it on to the world of accelerators. Of course, there are some limited devices that will not support all the constructs. And on some devices, expressing certain things in a certain way does not make sense performance-wise. I will discuss that to some extent. So that's the downside part. So if you use OpenMP to program for an Intel mic, you might not get the optimal performance, for example, on an FPGA-based or DSP-based system. But in general, you can just write one source code and possibly parameterize it to support different devices. I will look at Saxby as an example on the slide, and then I will try to do a live experiment with a simple Pi code. So we take the simple host code and offload the computation to the mic, do some performance comparison of the host and the mic, see how expensive the offload is to really get you an idea that, well, it's a lot of work to really get performance out of it. And then I have an outlook, just one slide, on what we are currently working on in the language committee. So what will come in the future. And again, if you have any questions, feel free to interrupt me. What's an accelerator in OpenMP? In OpenMP, we tried to introduce accelerators in a very non-intrusive way. So, non-intrusive is probably not the right word. So we tried to be very open in what we can support as an accelerator. So the model is not geared toward the Intel mic. It's not geared toward an NVIDIA GPU or a GPU-type accelerator in general. So we are working with some companies, and we have some completely different devices here in-house based on ARM cores and, I don't know, DSPs, and also worked on devices with FPGAs, and we can use this programming model on these devices. Of course, we have to write slightly different code, but the programming model supports these special devices as well as a pretty general purpose mic. So what we assume is that this accelerator consists of a set of cores with different functionality from the host. So it's, in general, optimized for something special. It has possibly a limited or a different instruction set. So in general, what you can see is that we try to support a heterogeneous device. So we have something like the host and something that is what we call the accelerator. In OpenMP, we call it we have a construct that is target, and we talk about the device. So we have the host and the device. And yeah, that's a model. So every accelerator, possibly multiple of those. In the current standard, we only support one kind of accelerator device for a given program code. But in the future, it might be multiple different accelerators. And these accelerators are attached to the host. But the only qualification that makes the host is the host that there the program starts. So we have a host-centric execution model. I will come to that in two slides. But it doesn't say that the x86 machine is a host. I think I will illustrate that later on. So we have a heterogeneous system. The accelerator might be programmable in the same language as a host, but it might also not be programmable in the same language as the host. For example, on several devices, you're not allowed or able to do I/O operations. So it means the I/O part has to be transferred back to the host, and only then you can do the file I/O, network I/O, sending MPI messages or whatever. It might not implement all the operations available on the host. So that's an example, or the I/O part is an example for that again. And that's part of the actual OpenMP implementation. So when you compile an OpenMP 4 program with this target support, you have to, or its implementation defined how to specify which device to be supported. In our demos today, we are using the Intel compiler, and this compiler will automatically generate code for the Intel Mic or Intel Xeon Phi processor as soon as it encounters a target construct. But other compilers behave slightly different, and you have to specify using the implementation at hand for which system to generate the code. And if then during the code generation, it will determine that something cannot be implemented on the device, the implementation will tell you so. So that means that the current state of the world, in which accelerators are not always equally capable of doing certain things. Some codes might be compilable for one accelerator, but not for another accelerator. This is an important thing. The accelerator may or may not share with memory with a host device. So I will talk about clauses to transfer data from the host to the accelerator. And whenever I say copy, I'm saying something wrong, because in the specification, we're not talking about copying. We're talking about mapping. So that means the standard supports, in principle, accelerators that share the memory with the host, for example, this functionality to be integrated with the host processor. And I think that's an important differentiation of, from some other features or some other similar languages. So it may or may not share memory with the host. The current mic certainly or clearly has a different physical memory location. And some accelerators are specialized for loop nests. So in OpenMP 4.0, we do not support all the different options to write parallel programs on accelerators. There are some limitations, as we will see them later on. But we also introduced special new constructs that only work for accelerators in order to parallelize hierarchical loops, which are which often can be well exploited on these devices. Good. I already said that the OpenMP accelerator model is host-centric. That means we start the OpenMP program with a single thread on something that we call the host. And then we have so-called target regions, and the target regions are offloaded to target devices. We do not say that the host is more capable than the device. So it's absolutely possible, and we have written example programs to explore that, that the mic is the host, and we do an offload to the Xeon. So that's possible. We don't have any codes like this in production, but one could envision that you have just the computational part on the mic, and you do an offloading of the I/O, for example, to the Xeon. So that's possible, and that I think underlines some of the flexibility that we have here. In the current implementations, as well as currently in the standard, we have only a synchronous model. So that means whenever a target region is encountered, we will see source code in a few minutes, the host thread is put to sleep because a control flow switches over to the device. And when the target region is completed, the control flow goes back to the host, and then the thread continues right after this target region. That's called an asynchronous offload, synchronous offload, I'm sorry. Really, synchronous offload, because the host is put to sleep. Only in the next version of the OpenMP standard, we are working on introducing asynchronicity. So that's not really possible at the moment. And that also means that the thread that performed an offload with a task construct is not available to work on other tasks. So there are some certain limitations at the moment, but for several programs they do not pose a problem. For some others they do, and this is why we're working on extensions already. However, if you write and compile code for a certain device, like the mic, and the executable is executed on a machine where the device is not present, or where there's a different device, or whatever, it's not available, then the target region is executed by the host device. So the OpenMP specification requires that there's always an alternative code path so that the program can execute without a severe error, meaning you get a result. It might be slower, there might be floating point differences between the host and the device, so that's something the language, the OpenMP language cannot deal with or does not deal with at the moment, but the resulting executable can always be executed. And I didn't talk in detail about the data environment concept in OpenMP, but I talked about the scoping, the shared and private, and all this is carried on towards the device. And we will later on see that we have certain constructs to manage the data environment on the device, which persists just one kernel, so we can make it live longer than just the offload of one region. That's also important, but that's also supported by OpenACC and CUDA and other constructs, languages. And I already mentioned this data mapping, which is a correlation of the data copying in OpenACC and CUDA. So I'm really trying to talk about data mapping. And we always have a corresponding, talking about the original data which is on the host, and then we're taking some part of the data and transferring it to the device, or mapping it to the device. And we're using the following terminology here. So we have an original variable, we have which is a one on the host, we have a corresponding variable, which is then the one on the device. And again, that might be the same memory behind it, or might be different memory. And this also imposes some restrictions, so that when a variable is mapped to the device and you're going to change it, and then it's mapped back, it depends on the scheduling of things again, and that would be considered a data race, and that would then be considered to be a an undefined program because it doesn't obey to the OpenMP standard. Okay, so original is a variable on the host, corresponding is a variable on the device, and we can transfer values. You as a programmer, you should think in terms of variable values and not of actual variable instances, because the device data environment is responsible for creating and deleting the variables and the storage, so that's all dealt with in the OpenMP implementation, and this is why we have this construct of the data environment. But I don't think it's necessary to go into detail here when we just want to look at the first programming examples here. Okay, let's take a look at an example. So data environment is lexically scoped. If you remember, OpenMP was as private, the lifetime of the private variable began at the end of the structured block, that's how I called it, for example, the beginning of a parallel region. And the private variables of all the threads were, well, deleted, destroyed, whatever, at the end of the structured block, for example, the end of a parallel region. And that's similar to what we have with the data environment here on the device. If we have a target construct that maps some data, the variable is created on the device and lives there as long as a kernel is executed on the device, meaning as it's destroyed or deleted at the end of the target construct. There are certain target data constructs that I will discuss in a minute, which lets you artificially extend the lifetime of data to more than just one kernel. And it's also, again, I mentioned it, the transfer is controlled from the host to the device, so technically the host thread is put to sleep. And that's what we have here, that's a host, and here's some data. And that's my device, and now I have a fancy animation, and I hope it works, because it was broken yesterday. So I say pragma omp target, that's a fundamental construct. I will talk about constructs on one of the next slides. And that performs this basic offload. And I have certain options to control what's going on with variables. So map is our clause that we used to manage the data environment on the device. And alloc means I create a new variable on the device for which there's no correspondence on the host. To means I have a variable on the host and I transfer the value. I map the value. I do not necessarily copy on the mic. I have to copy it, but I think I explained it. So map to means I copy data to the device. Then I execute my kernel on the device, meaning the host sleeps. Map from means at the end of the kernel. So when this is execution is completed, the data is, transferred back, mapped back to the host. And, if I don't say anything, to and from is a default. Scalar variables are already automatically mapped, as long as the compiler can determine that. But all the non-scalar variables have to be mapped manually. So that means if you have arrays, you have to transfer them manually to the device. If you have complex data structures and so on, you have to do it also manually. There are certain things that come to help. For example, we have array shaping, array sections, and to some extent also shaping expressions. So that means if you have a large array, but you also only want to transfer a chunk of this array to the device, we have extended the base languages so that you can express that. In Fortran, Fortran provides support for that, but we extended C and C++ to do this. Does it make sense? So target means I have this kernel here, I want to execute this as an offload on the device, and I need the following data clauses here. So that means I carry the data with me, and exactly the data that I need. Okay, so that's a principle, or basic principle, or general principle of the offload model. So let's look at a code example. And, OMP default device, that's not of much use unless you're going to use multiple devices of the same type in a code. But we do not care for that for the moment. We are just trying to exploit one device. Okay, so I have some array B of dimension n, and I assume this is initialized with some data. And usually on the host, I would write something like this: pragma omp parallel 4. I iterate from 0 to the n minus 1, and for every element, I call xenos of B of I. So that's something I could parallelize. Assuming that n is sufficiently large. If I want to execute that on my accelerator, I can say pragma omp target, device 0 is a standard, so we can ignore that for now, but that means I go to the first accelerator device, and I have to carry my array B. So I have to carry it over to the device, I have to map it in there because I'm working on the values, and because I'm interested in the result, I also have to carry it back. And that will perform the offload on the mic. Does it make sense? Okay. Do you expect this to be profitable? For an n, let's say, I don't know, a million. That would scale on the host. Do you think that's profitable? Yes? Who said yes? Yes. Why do you think? Okay. In my example later on, I will take a look at the time we spend in the compute kernel on the mic and the overall time we needed for our program to complete. And the operation will scale on the mic, you're right, but what you're not thinking of, I think, is the overhead of transferring the data to the device and back. And the device is attached to the PCI Express bus. That's awfully slow compared to the memory bandwidth. So I don't think you can make this code run faster by using an accelerator than by using vectorization and parallelization on the host. So the data transfer is really the bottleneck. You have to keep that in mind whenever you're working with accelerators. Does it pay off to transfer all the data to the host, do the parallel computation, and transfer it back? So unless you have a real, I don't know, long running, so long running in computer terms, whatever that means, if you have a real kernel that you offload to a device, unless you have that, it doesn't pay off. Furthermore, you should always compare to a parallel host. So if you see any numbers like 80 speed up by using GPUs or the mic, that's, sorry, that's bullshit. So if you compare parallel execution on the host and you tune for the host, and if you then compare a parallel execution, for example, on NVIDIA GPU, if you look at power consumption, if you ignore the power consumption and cost, just look at the theoretical possibilities that the hardware can speed up, the maximum performance that you get can get is a 5x improvement. Otherwise, you're doing something wrong on the host. And a 5x improvement might be worth it. So if your code is going to use millions of core hours, that's certainly a very good investment to go for accelerators. But if you just execute your code a few times and then you're going on with the next code, the next project, or whatever, then it's not worth it. Okay, so that's kind of the realistic expectation that you can get. And then you should really try to aim for using the parallel host and the accelerator. And this is when you're then efficient. But that's really a lot of work. Okay, that just as a side remark. Good. So, and this is the beauty of OpenMP. For all, you just say target, and it works. However, I already mentioned that certain accelerators do not work well unless you exploit the memory hierarchy and you do some structuring of loops. So tomorrow, Sandra will talk about OpenACC in detail, and she will talk about NVIDIA architectures, and she will explain why we have to do the following here when we optimize for an NVIDIA GPU. So this will work fine on the Xeon Phi, because at the end of the day, as Tim explained, it consists of standard Xeon cores. They are slow cores, in order, and whatever. But it's not Xeon, x86 cores. NVIDIA GPUs are built in a completely different way. Also, if you remember my talk on Monday, there was a brief overview about that. So we have to do certain different things here. And this is what OpenMP proposes to support to support the special blocking of loops. I said loop nests are often important codes for these accelerator type architectures. So what we say here is OMP teams distributed parallel 4. So teams and OpenMP thread team consists of the master and several worker thread. So the teams construct creates a set of OpenMP teams, but only the master is active. So it kind of reserves some space on the device, kind of space, so you have several OpenMP teams, but only the master thread is active, but there's space for worker threads. And distributes the loop iterations such that the teams construct can be applied. So it distributes the loop iterations so that only the masters of these teams work on it. And then every master basically is executing one of these blocks here. We have a parallel region, so that fills these teams, or that makes these teams come alive. If you compare this with tomorrow, I will compare this with OpenACC in a minute, you will see that we do exactly the same for OpenACC with this loop gang vector scheduling. So we have to use this hierarchical architecture of the GPU in order to get the full performance. So you can compile, in principle, you could compile that from GPGPU. If you have a really smart compiler, it would do something like this. But this will give you the best performance. The good news is that you can compile this for the Xeon Phi, and it will also give you a good performance. So that's kind of a problem, but performance portability in general is a problem. So the better you tune for a given architecture, the more often you run into problems when you go to another architecture. So that's, I'm telling you the truth, that that's a pain for users at the moment, and it will take some time until accelerator devices converge more. And then I said it on Monday, so if you take a look at the history, the compute cores on the NVIDIA get more powerful over time, so they're kind of approaching the Xeon cores, and Intel took the Xeon Phi with simpler cores, so with a little bit of luck, they will meet somewhere in the middle. And so that's a comparison. Here's the my code, NVIDIA code, and that's OpenACC. So we say OpenACC parallel, that's launching a kernel basically. Here we copy the B, and we have ACC loop gang vector, which instructs the compiler to automatically split this code in the way we did it manually here. And the good news is we have an equivalent in OpenMP, and says Pragma OMP teams distribute parallel 4. Thank you very much. I think that's what Root mentioned with OpenWound yesterday. It's clearly way to go to have the pragmas and constructs be getting longer and more complex. And if you take a look here, we can say these num blocks, block size, and here we can also control the number of threads, and this is then how you can specify how the loops should be split up. That's what you have to do for certain accelerators. Just be aware of it. Programming them is sometimes even more, or getting right the performance, if you want to get the right performance, programming them is sometimes even more complex than doing the same on the host. Any questions at the moment? Okay. So I will take a closer look at the constructs here. And I didn't mention the target data region so far. I will need it in my artificial example later on. Pragma OMP target data establishes a data environment. So the target data also consists of a structured block, meaning a beginning curly brace and an ending curly brace somewhere. And you can map the variables from the host to the device. That's not synchronous. So that means as soon as the target data is encountered, the data environment will be established on the host, but the host thread continues. The control flow is not transferred to the device. It will just map the variables. And then you can encounter multiple kernels on the device, and only at the end of the target data clause, the variables are deleted. And well, you can make the target data as large as you need. For example, you can they can span for the whole main routine. Why do we need something like this target data, so that the data can stay on the device for just more than one kernel call? Why do we need it? No idea? I want to separate local memory and device memory. Yeah, and what's the advantage of doing so? Why do I want that? Just necessary. I'm not happy with that answer. So what's the... Yes? Didn't get that, sorry. Yes, I think you're meaning right. To avoid excessive copying, right. I said the bottleneck when using the accelerator is really the data transfer. So what you might want to do is transfer the data to the accelerator and keep it there if you call multiple kernels or the same kernel multiple times. Only the data that has to be updated from the host to the accelerator, or updated back from the accelerator to the host, for example, to print a residual or whatever, that should be transferred. Otherwise, you really should avoid any data transfer if possible. And the target data gives you a tool to do so. So it's a large data environment that can span multiple kernels. And that's basically an optimization option. We also have the if clause. So that helped us yesterday with tasking to avoid the overhead. And for example, if your problem is too small that you do not want to use the accelerator, you can do the same. If the if expression evaluates to false, the device will be the host. So then all this target stuff will be ignored. I explained the map variable, so to and from actually creates new variables with a value from the hoster, from the host, and the alloc, I think I said it, creates a new variable which is, has an undefined initial value. You can think of it like something like device private. So that was one of the names we used early on when working on this proposal, but alloc is really more what it does, so it just reserves the memory and does not initialize it. And to from, the default is a combination of to and from. Okay? And the map clause as a clause can be put to the target construct and the target data construct. And that's a target construct, so it supports a device ID. If you have multiple devices of the same type, you can, if you really work hard, distribute your data and the parallelization over multiple devices. It supports a map clause and the if construct, and it's really a synchronous offload. So the target construct is encountered, control flow goes off to the accelerator or the device, it comes back, and only at the end of the structured block, the host thread will execute, continue the execution, and only after the kernel on the device has been completed. There's no good way for efficient asynchronous offload in OpenMP at the moment. Yeah, and that's another example, and well, it illustrates what I said before. So the excuse me. That's again the mic style approach. So you have a simple loop doing something parallelized with a parallel for. You can control, you can transfer this to the device, or if you want to support blocking on your GPU type device, you have to use the Teams distribute parallel for to really change the way the memory hierarchy can be used. So I hope that really makes sense. So Teams creates a Teams of thread. I will come to that in a second. But only the master is active and distributes this loop so that the loop iterations are executed by the teams. But this is some kind of blocking here. So there's we artificially introduce some blocking, and then within each block we do a parallel for. So the parameterization, how much data to be worked on within a block and things like that, that clearly depends on the device and might require some tweaking. There's no implementation of OpenMP 4.0 for GPUs available at the moment. So for the mic, we do not have to do that. But it's really important to understand that for GPUs, you have to work write code in a different way. The target update construct allows to transfer data between the host and the device. So to moves something from the host and pulls something from the device. Sorry, to moves something to the device and from pulls something from the device to the host. I'm not sure whether I've seen a real code that requires a target update at the moment. The problem is you don't know exactly if you, for example, call it from the host, how far your computation on the device has progressed meanwhile. So in OpenACC there's a notion of some signals, and that works better. So I'm not quite happy with a construct. So if Sandra is happy with a construct, she might explain later on. Or do you see the same problem? Yeah, so I mean that's addressed in the for OpenMP 4.1, but I think it's really hard to understand when to apply it, because really you don't know if you're pulling from the host some data from the device to the host, how far is the computation on the device. So I mean you could write to a variable and check if the variable has been set to 1, then I pull the real data. So you could pull as long as the variable has changed, but I think that's ugly. So we need some signal mechanism here. OpenACC has it, OpenMP doesn't at the moment, but the language committee is working on it. Declare target directive. So we need this for two things. First, for thread private variables, and second, for functions. So if your kernel calls other functions, possibly they are located in different source code files, they have to be available in a form that's capable to be executed on the device. So if you want the function to be callable from both the host and the device, you have to add the pragma-omp-declare target in front of this function. And that will make the compiler generate automatically two versions of that function. Standard version for the host and the second version for the accelerator. That's really important. Otherwise, you will get a compiler error or linker error because the function is not available. Furthermore, thread static variables. So if you want to have a static variable also be present on the device, you have to declare it in a similar way with the pragma-omp-declare target, and that will create static variables on the device. For Fortran, there are subroutines, and it's similar so that you have to declare these functions or subroutines to be present on the device. I will use it in my example as well. Yes, please. What do you mean with library call? You mean like glibc, like a malloc? Well, it depends on whether the library is available on the device. So OpenMP doesn't do any magic. It doesn't recompile all your system libraries and make them available on the device. So if your code calls a library for which you only have a host version, you cannot offload this code to the device unless in the device you do a transfer of the data back to perform the call. And now we become again device dependent. So on the Intel mic, most of glibc is available. It just works. On an NVIDIA GPGPU, I wouldn't bet on that. Okay? Or, well, on the current GPGPU type, I didn't mean to blame NVIDIA in any way. So it really depends on the device. Don't worry, I think we have time. How do I specify how to compile on the device? It again is implementation defined. So Intel's implementation allows me to just generate code for the mic as well. And Tim explained it, so I can either on the host cross-compile for the mic, or if I use the target construct, it will automatically generate the code for the mic. On a different implementation, there could be different ways. So that's what we call an OpenMP implementation defined. On Cray compilers, you have to specify a flag. I forgot. So I think it is something with target, so you specify the target architecture. Okay? Yeah, and if you need a library on the device, you might have to compile it for the device and make it available. You have to deploy it and whatever. Good. Teams construct. So we came up with a nice new name in OpenMP, actually that was born over a beer. So we are creating multiple teams. How do we call this collection of multiple teams? Well, let's come up with the leak. And the next day, no one had a better proposal. So this is how the name found its way into the standard. So I explained it, I think. So the team creates a placeholder for a set of team of threads, and only the master is active. So the team region is executed by the master thread of each team. And all these teams together are called the leak. And the threads other than the master do not begin the execution until the master thread encounters the parallel region. And this is why we need to distribute. So we distribute the loop iterations among the masters of the teams, because only the masters are active. And then we have the parallel four inside to activate all the other threads. And there are certain limitations, obviously. So it can only be followed by a distribute. And then the parallel constructs, because we need something to create a team in order to enable all the teams. We are working on making this a more general concept in OpenMP 4.1 or 5.0, but at the moment, the teams is only available on the accelerators, and only, I think, the only users for really exploit the hierarchical memory of accelerators. Yeah, that's what I said. The team construct must be contained within a target construct. Currently, you cannot make use of that on the host. And the distribute at the moment currently only makes sense together with the teams construct. So it takes a loop, but other than the for loop, it doesn't distribute the iterations in the current team. It distributes the iteration in the leak. It accepts similar clauses, so you can make variable private, first private. We discussed that with the collapse. We can ask the compiler to fuse multiple loops into a single one so that we can exploit more parallelism. And with the dist schedule, we can use the same schedules as with a for loop, but well, it's a distribute. So this is why we named the clause in a different way. So the for loops are required to have the same simple form, meaning that the number of iterations can be computed at the time the loop is encountered in the program flow. That's also the requirement of the for work sharing construct. And in previous talks, some people raised their hand. So does it more make sense to use teams distribute parallel for, or should I use the collapse? And what about adding the SIMD construct? Dirk will talk about that later on. And what in general gives me the best performance? So my best answer at the moment is really I have no clue. And actually, I'm not sure whether there's a single setting that can give you the best performance. And it really depends on the device, and it also really depends on your code, in how far you best exploit the hierarchical memory structure of the device. So yesterday we spent some time talking about OpenMP and optimizing for caches, for NUMA and things like that. So we learned how to understand that there's an hierarchical memory architecture, and the very same is true on the device. So all what you have learned on the host regarding tuning and things like that, you can apply it on the device. I think it will always result in better code, and it will not hurt you. And also the vice versa is true. So if you optimize for a device, you do all this blocking and things like that, usually it also performs if you port that back to the host version, because blocking in general is good for cache-based systems. And working on locality or whatever, better memory access always is good for better memory bandwidth and exploitation of NUMA architectures and things like that. So at the moment, I think that the tuning techniques that you have to apply for the host and the mic, or in general accelerators, are very similar. And I think that's the good news. So accelerators will change, but I think the tuning techniques will stay pretty much the same. And let's look at a slightly artificial example. So Sandra has come up with that, I don't know, 1 or 2 years ago. So we do two SUXPs for whatever reason. We want to exploit that we can keep some data on the device. So let me see. So we are allocating X and Y with a dimension of N. So we're doing Y equals A times X plus Y. And we do then Y equals B times X plus Y. So we're doing two SUXPs, and the hope is that some, or the optimization will be that some data can stay on the device. How to do it with OpenACC? So you will learn about that tomorrow, but most people looking for accelerator programming are familiar with OpenACC and just want to learn about OpenMP, so this is why I have this version first. So OpenACC also has a data environment. That means it will copy X to the device, and it will stay there. And then we do two kernels. We will copy Y to the device, because we assume here on the host we do something with the Y. That's why we have to copy it twice. But the X can stay on the device, so we are saving some data transfer here. This is the same in OpenMP, and I think that's more interesting here. So pragma-omp target data. The target data region begins here and ends there. So I hope you can see it here in the back. So right at the bottom of the screen, that's the end of the target data region. We say we want the X mapped to the device. So X is copied. The values of X are copied to the device here, and X will be destroyed only at the end of the target data region. And because we're only saying two, the X will not be copied back. We don't need it. We don't modify it on the accelerator. We just need to read it on the accelerator and then we can throw it away. Here we have the target construct with a map to from Y. Here we have to say to and from because we copy Y to the accelerator, perform the computation. We assume we need it on the host. We copy, so that means at the end of the target construct it will be copied back. And then again to from, we copy to the device the values and then they are copied back at the end of the target construct. And we're making use of the teams distribute parallel 4 without any manual blocking, so we ask the compiler to do something good. It might do something good, it might do something not so good. So if you want to get the good performance, you probably have to do the blocking yourself, but that's also supported. And yes? Which one? The Y? For the Y? Ah, you didn't listen. So I said, I assume I do something with Y on the host. So probably I should add a mark. So I'm doing the Saxby twice for whatever reason, but I do the Y on the device, and then I need it on the host again, and then I copy an updated value to the device. So that's the assumption of my kernel, but apparently I didn't write it onto the slide. Oh, I'm sorry. Clearly my fault. No. So that doing on the host is not visible in my example. So let me try to fix it. Assume Y is needed and modified on the host right here. Okay. So that's what I, I will update the slides to make that more clear. Sorry. Yes, please. Copying is slow. We will see that in the demo in a second or in a few minutes. You should avoid data transfer whenever possible. However, if you do not transfer data to the device, it's hard to make use of it. So, I mean, it's PCI Express bus. That's, I don't know, 6 gigabytes per second. Does it make sense? Or 3? Pablo? Yeah, 6? Roughly 6 gigabytes per second. Main memory bandwidth, remember on Monday, with our 3-year-old Westmere, we are 20 gigabytes per second. With the Sandy Bridge, I don't know, we're close to 40 single socket. PCI Express, still 6. Plus there's some overhead of the transfer software and things like that. So that's why I said transfer is slow. And latency is way, way worse. So in computer terms, these devices are far apart, here at the other end of the room, while the main memory is right beside me. So I have to be careful when sending data over there. And this is what changed. If you Google for it, NVIDIA has, I'm not remembering the name, but they're talking about, I think it's NVLink. So if you Google for it, I don't know what's public, but they are changing that. And that's really key. So this acceleration capabilities will kind of be get closer to the CPU or maybe merged, and that's the only way for it to be more effective and more productive. Personal opinion. And this is how it would look like on the mic. Again, here I do something on the host, so I have the target data map as previously, and I do not need the teams distribute. Parallel 4, I just need the parallel 4 because the mic is a full-featured x86 architecture and you can just execute a parallel region with up to 240 threads. Okay? Good. Let's do a live experiment. That's my host version of Pi, so we parallelized it yesterday. So that's the loop. I'm going to the order of millions of intervals. I do this naive numerical integration. I have to privatize X. I have to do the reduction over sum. I have the parallel region. How can I derive an accelerated OpenMP version out of that? What do I have to do? Yes, please. Correct. Pragma OMP declare target. So I have to only say pragma OMP declare target for f in this example, because compute pi is a function that contains a kernel. But if I would like to call compute pi from the host, I would also have to declare a target. Yes, so I have to do that. Something else? Well, I have to perform the actual offload. So, oh, there's a typo. Pragma OMP declare target for the function f, and I say pragma OMP target, which will offload the whole parallel region to the mic. I do not have to do anything regarding data, I think, because x, sum, num intervals are all scalar variables, and these are mapped automatically. Okay, so live demos can always fail, so wish me a bit of luck. It's pi offload. Pi host. So that's my simple host version. Oops, sorry. With f, pragma OMP parallel, pragma OMP 4. So I opened the work sharing construct for whatever reason, no real reason. I will compile it for the host. I will say icc-03-openmp-pi-host-pi-host-exe. Compiles, I execute omp num threads equals 1. Tim, may I ask for your assistance so that you record some timing information? I want to compute speedups. Is that possible? On the host, single thread, 0.8 seconds. Ah, thank you very much. I also need assistance to pay attention. I log into cluster Xeon Phi. What? Cluster Phi. There we are. Shared memory, what was it? Examples 08. OMP num threads equals 1. I do KMP affinity equals. It doesn't matter, I think. I have the machine for me by host. Okay, same number. Surprising. One thread, 0.8. You got that on the host. Two threads, 0.42. Four threads, 0.21. Let's go to 8. 8 threads, 0.11. It's Sandy Bridge with 8 physical cores, correct? Cluster Phi. Yes. 16 threads, 0.06. Okay, so you can probably come up with a nice diagram here, eh? And then print do a speed up plot. Let's take a look at the Pi Excel version, accelerated version. So I just said pragma OMP target in front of the parallel region, so I didn't do any magic here. And my function f, I say pragma OMP declare target. And I will compile openmp by excel c-o by excel excel. And now we are back at the implementation defined things. So the openmp compiler of Intel, when it encounters a target construct, will just automatically generate code for the Xeon Phi. Okay, mp affinity equals scatter omp num threads equals 1 pi excel. Bam. Do you think something's broken? No. So we're back in the old days of Pentium cores. So we're executing single-threaded on the mic. 18.6 seconds. There's now a very nice tool, export offload report equals 2. I'm a big fan of if the implementations give me simple indications about performance and what's going on. So I set this environment variable to 2, and I get some additional information from the Intel runtime. Let me wait for another 20 seconds. Da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. So, program execution time 18.4 seconds. Mic time, we only offloaded one kernel, 17.4 seconds. Okay? The rest is overhead. Well, it's not only data transferred. You have to say, hey, Mike, here's some computation. Wake up. Okay. 9.6 with 2 threads. Now you have to record 2 columns, please, Tim. 9.6 or 9.7, sorry, total, and 8.7 mic kernel time, okay? Let's go to, I don't know, how many calls do we have? Give me a number, 10. No, let's do something that can be compared to the host, sorry. First, I think we did 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, right? So, with 4 threads, you see the numbers, Tim, you will record them on your own, okay? Thank you. It's 8. So we see 3.1 to 2.2. 16. And so let's go, I don't know, to 30 cores. Ah, too fast for you, Tim. Okay, 50 cores, that's 50 cores. I will now go to 59. You're done with 50? And let's also try. You're done with 59? Okay, so with 60, well, you should on. So that's a lesson we learned with big SMP machines. Always leave some room for the operating system. It has to manage quite a lot of things. And the mic is not big, but it's an SMP with many cores and many threads. Actually, so the number of threads is really small, so let's. No, we can't. We don't do better here, huh? 0.37. Is 0.37 better than what we had? Yeah. So with 220 threads, 0.37 seconds, and 1.3 real wall clock time. So what we're seeing here is that the kernel has some nice speed up on the mic, but that's the overhead of offloading. So do not forget that. Even if a kernel scales nicely, it has to be large enough for your program to pay off. So what was the fastest execution time on the host, Tim? Oh, 0.058. So we are way faster than with the mic. I think we should tune the file code so that it runs faster than 0.37, but maybe we can learn about Dirk doing some vectorization to some limited extent on the code. And this live demo wasn't planned, so I didn't look whether we can do much for the code. It was just a spontaneous idea yesterday. But I think it teaches the lesson 0.37. Well, the mic on this particular code is slower, but what counts is like this. So 0.13 second is including the offload. If you want, in the exercises later on, it's a nice game to rewrite the Pi code so that some computation is on the done on the host and some computation is done on the mic. That can give you actually a nice performance if you really crank up the number of intervals. So you really have to go for a large number of intervals so that this offload time pays off. We have some other examples for the mic as well. Okay, so what was the speed up on the mic? The best effort speed up? A speed up of 14 on the host. Huh? I think you need a computer accelerator there, huh? What, 50? No, I mean for the kernel. Ah, so 0.37 is the best, and let me execute with 1. 17 or 18. Okay, yeah, let's assume 17 divided by 0.4. I'm very bad in math when standing in front of a class. 45, okay. So if you want to write a paper on the mic and accelerators, you should clearly go for a speed-up curve, because 45 speed-up is way better than, I only got a factor of 3 compared to the serial host, okay? So you got the marketing trick. Good, so that was a simple motivational example on the mic. We didn't get faster, but it was also pretty simple. Of course, you want to get faster, you have to invest more work. What are we doing in OpenMP? So we forgot some of the funky combinations. What we can aim to say or to enable to say is PragmaOMP target. Ah, I still forgot it. Target teams. I see my slides are too small here. Okay, now it fits onto a single line. PragmaOMP target. Ah, typo. Let me read it out in the full beauty. Teams. So, PragmaOMP target. Teams distribute parallel for SIMD. We forgot about this nice little new OpenMP4 feature that Dirk will talk about. SIMD is to instruct the compiler to generate vectorized code, which is very important, for example, on the mic. So, long Pragma or construct, really not always simple to understand what's going on. And there are some corner cases. So what happens if two threads start a target region and they map the same variable to the mic or to the device, sorry. Well, that's probably undefined what happens, but we didn't say so in the standard. So it's really a lot of corner cases to think of and some we forgot. What we will introduce is PragmaOMP task target, and this will allow an asynchronous offload. So that means the host will offload the kernel to the device and then continue the execution. And this is, I think, something I like, where the task construct from the host, which in principle expresses some asynchronicity as well, can be combined with the target construct. So that will offload the target region to the host, and because a task might be executed now or deferred, that means it will be an asynchronous offload. And yesterday I briefly talked about task dependencies. We ensured ourselves that if we add target in between some tasks with dependencies, we can define that it will always work. Whether it will get good performance will depend on your code. But at the moment we think that tasks, target, tasks on the host, and everything with dependencies can be made to work. So that means you could have a task target data with some dependence, and only when the data transfer has been completed, you can start some computation on the device. And that will allow for some more flexible distribution of work between the host and device, for example. What we don't have, but what OpenACC introduced, is unstructured data movement. So at the moment, we need the target data with a curly brace. At the beginning, it will be transferred. At the end, it will be transferred back or destroy the data. We are thinking of something like target enter data and exit data, and you need it, for example, if you write a class that in the allocator constructor, sorry, pushes some data to the device, and then the destructor removes that data from the device. At the moment, that's not possible because we have this very static and structured way of data movement, and this is what we call unstructured data movement. And there's a lot of discussion on supporting for multiple devices. And the problem is not only to support different devices of different type, but also how to distribute data and work onto the device. It's the goal of the OpenMP subcommittee to offer some abstraction of that. Whether we will succeed, I'm not sure. I think that's a topic for OpenMP 5, which will be, I don't know, out in 3 years. Our ambitious goal is to have a standard on OpenMP 4.1 ready by the end of this year, maybe November time for the supercomputing. Maybe it will be early next year, we will see, and then implementations can already go ahead and improve these, implement these rather small improvements. That's it. Thank you very much for your attention so far. Do you have any questions?